This is a piece of code from a fully functional 8-bit Snake game, featuring razor-sharp graphics, mesmerizing gameplay, and even sound. The reason that the code looks like this is because it's written in brainfuck. I don't want to get demonetized, so I'll abbreviate the name to just BF. As you can probably tell by the name, this language is quite literally designed to give you a headache. I'm just one of the weirdos who finds it fun to work with. Remember, you're currently looking at a game engine. Point is, if you don't take notes on every little thing your code does, it's very easy to get lost. All programs written in BF look like unreadable garbage. It's not just my code, I promise. That's because the entire BF grammar consists of just 8 symbols. Other characters, like letters and even numbers, are simply ignored. But in theory, this is all you need to write any program, including a relatively complicated 2D game. Here's how it works. You're given a long array of numbers, which are all set to 0 by default. You've also got a cursor, which starts off pointing at the very first number. You can use these two instructions to move that cursor to the right or to the left. You can use the plus and minus symbols to add one or remove one from the currently selected number. The comma lets you read user input one symbol at a time, and the dot lets you output a symbol. Finally, the square brackets indicate a loop. Any code inside of here will repeat until the selected value becomes 0. And yep, that's all there is to it. Congratulations, you've successfully learned an entire programming language. Feel free to put that on your resume if you want, though maybe leave out the name, it's not very professional. Okay, so we've got the Legos, but how do you build a game with this? For that, we'll first need a screen. I wrote a program that visualizes the first 256 cells as pixels. This means that if we, for example, increase the value of the first cell, the first pixel will get brighter. If we do the same a few cells forward, we can light up a different pixel. Slowly, little by little, we can start to build a whole image. Technically, the screen doesn't have to be 16 by 16, but that does make it easier to work with when building a game. BF works with 8-bit values, which means that the highest number you can achieve is 255. Going over that will just flip the value back over to 0, and likewise, subtracting 1 from 0 will just bring you up to 255. A 16 by 16 pixel screen has exactly 256 pixels, which means that we can store something like the player position in just one cell. Actually, drawing a player based on this position is where it starts to get interesting. Say we're storing the position in the 256th cell, right outside of the pixel buffer. To draw the player at the given location, we need a way to convert this number to a set of cursor-moving instructions. Just hard-coding these isn't gonna work, because then you'd have to change the code to move the player. My solution to this was to use what I call a glider. It's a loop with just one arrow instruction inside, and what this does is it makes the cursor continuously move in one direction until it reaches a zero, at which point the loop will stop. That actually reframes the problem, as now we just need to fill some continuous volume of cells with positive values, which is a lot more plausible than jumping ahead. The code I'm using here just decrements the position counter, then glides into the pixel buffer, increments one value at the end of the chain, and glides right back. Rinse repeat, and you've got yourself a bunch of ones leading up to where the player is supposed to be. Now, if you just use another set of gliders, you can go to the end of this chain, draw a fully white pixel there, and then glide back while picking up your garbage along the way. Yeah, this is not what game programming normally looks like. At this point, you might say, what's the big deal? We were already drawing pixels ages ago. But here's the cool part, we can now put all of the drawing code in its own loop and make changes to the position each time the loop runs, which makes that pixel start moving. It's not quite Snake just yet, but we're getting there. What we need now is a way to control the player. I mentioned earlier that the comma operator can read symbols from user input, but in my engine, I've slightly tweaked it to give me a bit mask of controller inputs. Simply put, when I use the comma, I'll get back a number that can correspond to a button or a combination of buttons. To be clear, I'm not adding anything new, this is all still doable in vanilla BF. I'm effectively just remapping these inputs to be more intuitive for a game. So with that, and a bunch more BF code, I can finally start to move around a pixel on the screen, and depending on how easily entertained you are, one could already call this a game. Maybe. The fundamental concept that makes this, and the rest of the game, possible are conditionals. In most programming languages, these are expressions like, is x equal to 5, or is a less than b, but oh no, this is BF, we don't get such fancies, we just have a few increments and loops. Still, undeterred, we can make it work. If you think about it, the BF loop is kind of like a conditional that asks, is the number not equal to zero? If so, it'll run and repeat the code that's inside. If not, it'll jump forward and skip the loop. Now, that might seem like a dead end at first, but just watch. If we add a few subtractions before the loop, we can now start to ask questions like, is the number not equal to 3? Because this is basically the same as carrying the number 3 to the other side of the equation. We can also nest loops inside of each other to ask questions like, is the number not 3 or 4? And while it might seem like we're limited to just the not equal kinds of questions, there's actually a way to get around that too. Say we have a loop that always works. It has a dedicated flag number that will set to a non-zero value. No matter the number that comes before it, it'll always pass, because it's actually checking a completely different number. But remember, we've got the power to exclude any number, so we can add another loop before this that checks if the cursor is not pointing towards a 3, and if so, it'll flip that flag, which will now skip the second loop for anything that isn't a 3. This might be a lot to take in all at once, but essentially what this means is that we can start gluing together basic conditions, like is the left direction key pressed, and if so, change the player's position. But let's be honest, it's not really a game without an objective. So let's try adding another, slightly dimmer pixel. In Snake, this would be the apple. But that's kind of stupid, since snakes don't actually eat apples, so just between us, the protagonist of this game will actually be a very hungry caterpillar. Anyway, if we just copy the player rendering code, it seems to work at first, until you step to the right of it. This happens because of the way we're gliding across the screen. In a situation like this, the player gets drawn first, and then the apple's rendering routine has to glide over it to be drawn after. But the apple can't really distinguish between a marker it placed and a pixel that was already there, so the player effectively offsets the apple one cell to the left. I don't know if there's a good way to solve this, at least I haven't figured it out yet, and if I ever do, it's not like I'm going to come back and update my rendering pipeline. It's not exactly trivial to refactor a program written in BF. My solution is pretty dumb, but it does work. I just check if the player's coordinate is less than the apple's coordinate, and subtract one if so. The reason this approach sucks is that you now have to do this for every new pixel you add, making the code more and more of a brain fu- Sorry. Excuse me, almost got me there. Lastly, we need a way to randomize the position of the apple after it's been picked up. BF doesn't have any randomization functions per se, but just like many great NES games, we can simulate randomness by using a timer that counts up every frame. My engine runs this game at 60 FPS, and it'd be pretty hard to predict the exact value of that counter every time I pick up an apple, so it's basically random. Speaking of frame rate, it's actually pretty hard to control the player with how fast it moves at 60 FPS. I didn't mention this before, but I repurposed the dot operator that usually prints a single character to instead signal to my runtime that the frame buffer is ready for drawing. We could slow down the game by drawing multiple identical frames back to back, but that would make movement feel much less responsive. Instead, I'll increment a counter 32 times each frame, and only update the player's position once that counter wraps around to 0, which would be every 8th frame. This way, I can still read player input on every frame, but I process it at a much slower rate. Okay, so we've got a pretty awesome dot collection game, but this ain't no Snake. Where's the tail? Where's the... Just where's the tail? Well, drawing one piece of the tail is about the same as drawing another player that's just lagging behind by one tick. Making it longer is what's annoying, and I actually procrastinated on this so hard that I ended up implementing 8-bit color. This wasn't actually that hard. Instead of drawing each pixel as a brightness, I treat the numbers in the frame buffer as RGB332 color values. This basically means that certain numbers correspond to certain colors. So all I have to do to make the player green and the apple red is to just use those specific numbers when drawing the pixels. To change the color of the background, I can just add some number to every pixel in the frame buffer. That does also mess up the colors of the existing pixels, but this can be compensated for. Okay, enough of that, we do actually need a tail. There are two ways to go about this. We can either write a template for drawing one pixel of the tail and copy-paste that a bunch of times, or we can figure out how to implement arrays. And regardless of which option I'd choose, because of my crappy rendering pipeline, each tail piece would have to account for the position of every other tail piece to be ordered correctly. The elegant solution here, if you can call it that, is to use some kind of an array structure. Remember, we can't tell BF to get the nth tailpiece directly. We already solved a similar problem earlier with the frame buffer, but that was for writing to an empty canvas. This is the opposite. One way to do this is to free up twice the memory you would need and fill the second half with the coordinates. To retrieve an element from a specific index, you can shift the entire array backwards by that amount, and then go to where the first coordinate was. That will now hold your desired array element. This would be one of the more elegant and beautiful and dynamic ways to do things, but my code doesn't do this. I just wrote some JavaScript code that takes the template for drawing one tailpiece and copy-pastes it 16 times. That's the dumb and stinky approach, but the one benefit it does have is that it's actually quite a bit faster, especially because you'd otherwise have to shift the whole array a bajillion times to cross-compare all the tailpixel coordinates. And this might actually matter, as even with the cheaper approach, my caterpillar starts to not feel so good after a few too many apples. The solution to this is to just optimize the interpreter. For example, instead of executing individual plus instructions one by one, you can count them up ahead of time and store the exact amount to add. Likewise, instead of stepping all the way through a loop to find the beginning or end, we can count the distance between brackets ahead of time. This is actually how some basic compression systems work in the real world. With just a few changes like these, there's no longer any bit of lag remaining, even at full tail length. You could optimize this even further by converting this binary format into C code, and then compiling that down to actual machine code that runs natively on your processor, but I don't think our game will need that. Implementing a game over state for biting the tail is probably the easiest thing in this whole project. All you have to do is create an infinite loop that draws the same frame over and over. Now, I'd love to say that we're finally done with the game, but here comes the dreaded part. Debugging BF code. There are quite a few graphical bugs, and even more gameplay bugs. Just to name an example, if you move diagonally, you'll start skipping pixels, which basically lets you go through your own tail if you get lucky. I fixed that last one by making diagonal movements stepped. Basically, I've got a value that flip-flops between 0 and non-0 every time movement is processed. Then, instead of applying both coordinate changes for diagonal movement, I choose a direction based on that flag. This also ends up looking a lot more like what you'd expect. Since I also can't make the tail infinitely long, you can exploit the way the screen coordinates wrap around to do this, which is kind of like an infinite score glitch. To remedy that, I added this blue pixel that kills you on contact. You can think of it as a sort of bad apple. Hold on a second. Yes, I did also add sound to the runtime. The address that you've selected when you run the dot operator would normally be used to specify which character to print, but here it specifies a MIDI note to play for the rest of the frame. In my game, I added basic blip sound effects for picking up an apple, and a three-note sequence for when the player dies. I think that's about as good as it gets. Oh, and for the sake of completeness, I did also write a BF interpreter in Portal 2. It just felt wrong not to. Anyway, if you enjoyed this rabbit hole, you can subscribe for more unhinged side quests. And just in case you still have any doubts about this, here's the first frame of the game being run in a vanilla BF interpreter. There's no graphical output, of course, but the memory buffer does line up with the expected pixels. Alright, for real this time, that's all from me today. See ya!